The outcome of the last video was, if K is a compact operator and linear, if K is a compact operator, then there exists an orthonormal system of singular vectors UK and VK, and singular values sigma K larger than zero, that KU can be represented as sum over all K sigma K scalar product of U and UK times VK. Okay, so that's going to prove to be very useful, but let me first make some remarks. One thing that was somehow hidden in the derivation, somehow hidden in the proof, is why does that sum exist at all, right? And let me tell you why. Of course, we have that the sum over all U and UK squared, due to Bessel's inequality, is smaller or equal to the norm of U squared. So that already means, and that's because the UK are an orthonormal system, and the VK are an orthonormal system too. So even the sum over U and UK times VK exists. And now if we multiply by sigma K, sigma K are ordered, so we have sigma K plus 1, smaller or equal to sigma K. So this is a decreasing sequence, and this is definite, and so that all the coefficients we have this sigma 1 times scalar product of U and UK, so this can easily be estimated to above. But it's even better, because we already know that if the sigma k are an infinite sequence, then we have that sigma k tend to zero. So they even become much smaller, and even the convergence of the sum is even better, is definitely better than the convergence of the sequence that I started with. So it's even better than the convergence of this one. And this is going to be important when we look at the inverse problem. Okay, this one does exist, and there's no question about that. Second, it turns out that very often, while we do know that this representation exists, even for quite simple operators, it is quite difficult to obtain analytically. And one example, I think I deleted it from the exercises. If you look at the programming exercises for the last, I think it's sheet number 4, the next one, then there is a very simple convolution, and for this one, the singular value decomposition can be computed, but it already includes special functions like the integral sign. So these are special functions you usually do not come across in normal mathematical lectures. So it can be done. Many of the singular value decompositions can be computed, but it's always quite difficult, and usually we don't do it. So analytically computing the SVD is at least difficult. And let me add that for our main example, the radon transform, the SVD can be computed, but the computation is already beyond the scope of this lecture. So I will quote the result at some point, I think, but we won't prove it and we won't use it. Now, but
What do we use it for? Well, we use the existence for analyzing the operator, but we don't use it in practice. However, could we use it in practice, even if we don't know it analytically? I remind you that in one of the exercises, you showed that discretized operators for the integral operator, discretized operators converge towards the continuous operator with respect to the operator norm. So that's the strongest kind of convergence that we have. And you would somehow expect, okay, probably the singular vectors of the matrices that come up for the discretized problem in some way converge to the singular vectors, to the singular functions of the true continuous operator. And that's true in a way, and I'm going to show you one example a little bit later. Okay, so discretizing the problem. For example, for the integral operator, gives, as you saw, a matrix problem. So that is because I'm discretizing, you end up with a problem in a finite dimensional space. So then the operator can be represented by a matrix. And the SVD of the matrix, that means the singular values and singular vectors in some way converge to the singular value of the operator K. Now, convergence, we must define what we mean by convergence here. One, we have vectors on one side, we have functions on the other side, but when I show you the example, you'll very soon realize what I mean. Now, so we can compute approximations for singular functions. The thing is, don't use it. We will see that we will use the SVD only for analyzing problems, and we will finally not use it in practice to solve problems. And the reason simply is that the effort of computing the SVD and of computing the representation of computing all the scalar products is far too high, and we have much better ways of dealing with these problems than computing the SVD. In fact, if you look at one of the main programming or function packages that that are used for computing the SVD, that's LAPACK or LINPACK. That includes a routine for computing the SVD, but it has a big warning sign near to it. Use it only if there's really no other way. And this, the reason is simply that it's a big effort to compute it. It's a big effort even to compute the SVD of a matrix. And we will see there are better ways then. We can do better. And so we won't use it in practice. Okay, but we'll use it for the analysis, of course. Okay, and one of the main things that we will make use of in when we analyze imaging problems is that most of the SVDs of operators in imaging share a common property, and I will show you what that property is in a second. And maybe I should mention it now. I will show you, and then you will even easily see that. Because we'll look at an example now. And the example is one of the simplest problem you can think of. It's we define an operator K, let's say from L2 of 0, 1 to L2 of 0, 1. And this is going to be the one of the simplest integral operators. We define KU of x as the integral from 0 to x f of t dt. And that amounts to using the operator 0, or using the kernel functions k of x and t f of t dt, with the definition that k of x and t is equal to 1 for t less or equal to x and 0 else. Okay, now what is K adjoint? K adjoint V of T is, well, you can easily write it down. It's the integral 0 to 1, K of X and T, V of X, oh, not F, excuse me, oops. As always, the question, do we use V, F, or U? And I decided to use U here. And so that's K of X and T, V of X, dx. And since this is 1 for T smaller than X, we have here the integral from T to 1, V of x dx. Now we want to compute the singular value decomposition for that. So we need functions uk with the property, or functions u with the property that k star k u of t, or k star ku should be equal to sigma square times u. So then the u would be an eigenvector of k star k for the eigenvalue sigma square. So that's the equation that we need to fulfill. And now let's write this down. So we have sigma squared times u, evaluated at some t, is the same as the integral from t to 1, that's k adjoint, now integral from 0 to x, u of s ds and dx. Now, obviously, we have that u of 1 is 0. Because if we set t equal to 1, then we get, then that interval is gone. Assuming that u is differentiable, so first taking everything over continuous functions and then extending that, we have that the derivative at 0 is nothing but the integral over from 0. Yeah, if we differentiate this to t, we get integral from 0 to x, u of s ds. Now, if x is 0, then this is 0 as well.
just take the derivative of the right-hand side with respect to t. And again, assuming that u is twice differentiable, which it should, which it is if u is continuous, then we find that sigma square double prime of t, so second derivative is, well, if we differentiate the right-hand side, first the outer integral goes away, then the inner integral goes away, so this is nothing but u of s ds. U of t. It's nothing but u of t. Oh, I just realized I lost a minus sign. When differentiating the right-hand side with respect to t, this is the lower limit, so we get a minus sign there. Then differentiating with respect to x, that's the upper limit, so no problem. So we have minus u of t here, and that means that we end up with the boundary value problem, u of t, let me write it the usual way, u double prime of t minus 1 over sigma squared, u of t is 0, and the 1 over sigma squared makes sense because we only look for eigenvalues which are larger than 0. Okay, so this is a boundary value problem. We're looking for solutions with u of 1 equals 0, u prime of 0 equals to 0. And if you've ever looked into boundary value problems for second order problems, then this is the typical differential equation that you look at, and the different kind of equation even with the boundary values. And now looking at the different differential equation itself, more or less that says that the second derivative should be a multiple, negative of the function itself. So you easily think of the sine, and that's exactly what comes up. So together with the boundary value problems, you can easily show that cosine of pi over 2 plus n times pi multiplied with t. That's first a solution to the differential equation. That's not too much of a surprise because second derivative of the cosine is minus the cosine, and it also satisfies the boundary values. So this is a solution to the boundary value problem, and the sigma n's are 1, or sigma n squared is 1 over pi over 2 plus n times pi squared, which means that sigma n, so the singular value we've been looking for, is 1 over pi over 2 plus n times pi, which could probably be written in a nicer way. And of course, this should be a un. So we've found a sequence of eigenvectors and eigenvalues of our operator. And it turns out it's complete in the range. So that's all you can get. And so that's our singular value. So that's the right-hand side, singular vectors. And for the left side, singular vectors, we find that that should be a t over here. For the left-hand side, we find that Vn of t is the sine of x over sigma n. Let me write it this way. And un of t is the cosine. Writing it this way, it's the cosine of t over sigma n.
And so that's now an orthonormal system. That's now an orthogonal system. We need to make sure that all the vectors have norm 1. And it turns out, multiplying this with the square root of 2, this is not true.
And of course, maybe I should add this at this point. The sigma n is, writing it in a nicer way, is 2 over pi 1 over 2n plus 1.
Okay, so that's the, now writing it as a series, you now have the singular value decomposition. These are all the singular functions and singular values that come up. Now, let's check some of the things we said. For example, we have an unlimited sequence of eigenvalues, and that should go to zero, and in fact it does. This one converges to zero, and the order is 1 over n. And that's, again, that's going to be important. Now, what is the outcome of this? Well, the thing is, the singular vectors of the singular functions, I should. Now, I stress that these are really functions, are low frequency for n small or sigma n large. Now, what do I mean by that? Let's take n small, then sigma n is about 1 over, for example, and take n equal to 0, then we have 2 over pi. And that's relatively large because, and of course that becomes smaller when we take n larger. But what does that mean for the frequency of the Vn's and Un's? Now, if sigma n gets small, then 1 over sigma n gets large, and that means that this the frequency of the sine gets gets larger and larger. So for a very large n and very small sigma n, the Vn functions are very high frequency, and you immediately realize what that means, right? I mean, they oscillate at a high frequency. Now, this is the common property that I wanted to stress. Singular functions for small value, for large values of this of the singular value, for large singular values, are oscillating slowly. Singular functions for small singular values are oscillating very rapidly. Why that is important, we will see when we turn to the inverse thing. Okay, I don't know if I can show this to you. I've made a very small implementation of that. Now I can't share that this at this point, so well, maybe I can. Let me show that to you. Okay, I've prepared a small numerical test, and so this is the SVD. And this is in the Python programming environment. So I've implemented the operator K from the example as a matrix. And you can easily compute the singular value decomposition by using Python standard Python functions. And when you do that, this is the first singular vector that you get, and the first singular vector that we had computed was something like cosine of x times pi over 2. Now, this is definitely not cosine of x times pi over 2, times a constant. But, well, the thing is, the singular vectors are, of course, not unique, but if you multiply them with minus 1, then it's again, if you take a singular vector, multiply it with minus 1, and then you again have a singular vector with a norm 1. So up to a constant factor of norm of absolute value 1, these are unique only. And so this is a different one. I just computed a different one here. If you take the negative one of that, then you get a very good approximation to the first eigenvalue, to the first singular vector which we computed. Okay, so that means that I'm up to a scaling factor because I did the scaling wrong here. So we conclude that the singular vectors of an operator can be approximated using discretization and using standard routines from function packages. SVD is implemented in all of these. And there's another thing when I compute the singular values, these also follow the same scheme. So also the singular values are approximations of the true singular value. So the computer, so the singular values of the discretization are an approximation to the singular values of the true operator. And we can see this. I mean, they behave like 1 over n. So this should be when I plot this in a log plot, then that should be a line with slope 1, slope minus 1, and that's exactly what we have here. So they also share that property that the singular values go to 0 like 1 over n. Okay, so and now we'll discuss the relation of singular value and the minimum norm solution.